everyone where they are right now, no matter where they are, Father, you're with them. And we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 31. I thought that was. Okay, let's back up to verse 30 for a moment. And it says, and the time of this ignorance God winked at. And that was when they were looking at idols and different things and were worshiping idols. And to the unknown God, we talked about that last week. And he said, there were times when God winked at this ignorance, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. The more I keep talking to people around the world and I keep talking to different people. And I know the other announcement I want to make was August 16th to the 21st. Don't make any plans. Okay? Brother Ron Sutton is going to be with us. He wrote the book Devil in the Front Row. And I tell you, he's got several books that are really, really good, really good books. And I'm sure he'll bring them here so you can purchase them and read them. They're excellent books. He's going to be with us, and I'm excited. I talked to him today, and he's just excited. He said, I want to just come and sit with you, Pastor, and just talk with you. And he's going to stay in our home. He doesn't even want to stay in a hotel. He said, I want to stay with you just so we can fellowship together. And so I was excited about that. You know, Brother Sutton, you know, is the author of several books. He graduated, top of his class in honors, cum laude and all that stuff, you know. He's just a great guy, and he's just like Brother Diamond. He's funny, but he's serious at the same time. So I think you're going to enjoy him very much. So mark that down in your calendar, August 16th to the 21st. He will be here with us, and we're glad to have him come. Amen. So we got a busy schedule coming up. We got quite a few things going on. We got Brother Sajiv coming Friday. He'll be here for a month, and then May 6th. And that Sunday, we have Pastor Bob Layton and his wife, Elaine, coming May 6th. The first Sunday, I believe, is first Sunday in May. He'll be coming to share and fellowship with us. And then May 12th, my son Sam from Nigeria, he'll be here. Yeah, he's going to try to get here for the 12th so he can meet Sajiv and spend some time with him too. And so he'll be here for 3 weeks. So we have him here. June, I don't think we have anything going on. I hope not. July, we have something going on. Linda and I will be going to Pennsylvania for about 4 days. So we'll be gone in July. And then, of course, August is going to be Brother Sutton. And then September, I believe, Brother David Diamond will be here. If you never met David Diamond, you're in for a treat. David Diamond will get you laughing, get you crying, get you convicted, and get you right with God. Amen? So I don't have the dates as of yet. It's a little too far out yet. But we'll be doing that. Then October, I'll be supposedly going to Nigeria again for 10 days, I think. I can't go any more than that. But 10 days I'll be in Nigeria. And then, of course, we have November, December back in the wintertime again, and then we'll see what happens. Maybe God will even come by then, and I'll go, thank you, Jesus. You know, if Jesus comes back by then. Okay, so that's the announcements. I'm glad I remembered. And then 31, because he hath appointed a day. Everyone say appointed a day. God has specific times that he has ordained before the foundation of the world. God has a specific day. Isn't that cool? He's ordained it. It's going to happen. He says, he has an appointed day in which he will judge the world in righteousness. And the Bible says that judgment will begin where? In the house of God. That's where judgment's going to begin. I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to be cleaning house. He's going to be getting rid of some pastors. You're going to see some big-name pastors that are going to fall by the wayside. Mark what I'm telling you. It's going to happen. Because judgment's going to begin. Because a lot of them, I was watching one the other day on the government was interviewing him about what he's doing with the money. And he bought a Rolls Royce for $260,000. And he's got $3,000 suits. And he's spending $30,000 at Gucci's and all this other stuff, and they're asking him all these questions, and he's got the right answer. He talked to his lawyer, but again, I mean, that's not what the gospel's all about. Preaching's not about that. Churches are not about that. Shouldn't be about that. It's about souls. It's about touching people's lives and changing their lives. That's what it's supposed to be about. And you know, I don't blame God in any sense for judging His church, because we've made it a house of dens and house. This house of God is dens of thieves. We've made merchandise of God's people. All we look at is God's people as dollar signs and how to fulfill our ambitions and our pocketbooks so that we can retire with multi-million dollar mansions and multi-million dollar bank accounts. And I'm telling you right now, I don't have either. Praise God. Don't want it either. Hallelujah. I'm glad about that. I didn't get one amen, though. My wife didn't even amen that. I'm assuming maybe she wants a few little extra bucks in the bank. I don't know. But praise God. Vicky said, yeah, that's right. Okay. He says, there's going to be a appointed time of judgment, a day in which He will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom He hath ordained. So God has already ordained somebody, hallelujah, to judge the world. Now, see, that's where some people say, well, Jesus ain't going to judge. Yes, He is. How do we know the scripture's talking about Him? It could be about somebody else that God has going to raise up. No, it talks about Jesus. It says, whereof He hath given assurance to all men in that He hath raised Him from the dead. So that man that He's talking about is the one He raised from the dead. And there's only one that He raised to the dead that's going to come and judge, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Can somebody give me an amen? Hallelujah. So He's going to come and He's going to judge the world in righteousness. And it's not going to be their righteousness. It's not going to be a bunch of laws that they have to live up to. It's going to be His righteousness. And I can tell you right now that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's not one of us that can measure up to the righteousness of Jesus Christ and of God. So how is He going to judge us by in the world of righteousness then? Because what He's going to judge is whether we have appropriated that righteousness that is in Christ. And it's a free gift. I'm made righteous not because I'm holy, not because I'm righteous in and of myself. I'm made righteous because of the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for me and was shed for you. And if you don't have that righteousness, believe me, you're going to wish you did in that day. Because let me tell you, you ever hear the expression, all hell's going to break loose. And it's going to break loose that day to come and grab you and take your soul into hell forever and ever. Now, some people don't like that kind of preaching, but I want you to know that that's the kind of preaching we need. We need that kind of preaching because there's no conviction anymore. No, we're just allowing people to come into the church and live in sin and do all kinds of things. And we're not facing the facts that we need to preach about sin and hell and judgment and God's wrath and Jesus Christ coming back again to judge the world in righteousness. Come on, somebody. And verse 32 says, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead. Some people still want to keep Jesus dead. Some people still don't want to believe that Jesus Christ is alive. Some people would rather just avoid the whole subject of Jesus Christ. Many of them think it's a myth. Many of them think it's a story. Many of them think that it's not true. But my question to them is that how do you know it's not true? And they say, well, how do you know that it is? I said, because only the risen Jesus Christ could save my soul and change my life the way that He has affected it. And I'm not the only one. There are millions upon millions that have their lives have been changed and spared by the grace of God through Jesus Christ. Because the Bible says grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So if you want to know what the truth is, find Jesus, because He is the truth. He is the way. He is the life. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. That's nothing new. That's something that was going on during the Bible, still going on today. People mock and they laugh and they ridicule Christians and they say, oh, you little goody two-shoes and all that stuff. I say, well, If I got little goody two shoes, my little goody two shoes are going to heaven. Your little dirty shoes are going to hell. I like what Elizabeth Warren said. We're going to take our nasty little feet and we're going to take our nasty little self. And you know what? You're going to take your nasty little self and go to hell too. Along with your little nasty shoes. Come on. Lest they repent of their sins and get right with Jesus Christ. I pray that God will allow some of the politicians up in Boston to watch this. I do. I pray that God, let them see it. Let Elizabeth Warren tune in. You know why? Because she needs Jesus. She doesn't need feminism. She needs Jesus. But some mocked. And others said, we'll hear thee again of this matter. You ever have people like that? Oh, I got to go now. I can't talk now. I got to go. They avoid it. They avoid it. But there's going to be a day when they wish that they hadn't avoided it. The day they take their last breath and their spirit leaves their body, it's going to go somewhere. Amen. And when it goes somewhere, they're going to hope and pray that they made the right choice. Because what you choose now will affect your eternity, and that is forever. He said here in verse 34, howbeit that certain men, I'm buzzing here. I don't have a pacemaker, so I don't know what that's all about. Howbeit certain men, they clave unto him, they clung to them. They were, you know what? When you are filled with Jesus, people are attracted to you. When you have something in God, people want to be around you. They want to glean from you. They want to know what's different about you. Can they say that about your life? Can they say that, you're going to get those that are going to mock you. You're going to get those that will really ridicule you. You're going to get those that will talk about you, going to make fun of you and laugh at you. When people laugh at me or they ridicule me or they say things, I feel honored. I feel it's like a badge of honor. I say, well, God, thank you. I'm doing something right because the Bible says, woe unto you when all men speak well of you. I say, God, thank you. I must be doing something right because, they're talking about me. And thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Because I don't care. Because I know where I'm going and that's all that matters. And I know where they're going too. He says, among them was, I keep getting that little buzz sound. Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Demarius, and others with them. Maybe it's my phone. Yeah, see, it's gone away. Chapter 18. Well, we're moving right along here. And after these things, Paul departed from Athens in Greece, and came to Corinth. And he found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy. Hallelujah. With his wife, Priscilla. You didn't know that Priscilla got married, did you? Not our Priscilla, but this Priscilla. Because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome, and so he came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, Paul speaking of, he abode with him. What did Paul do? He was a tent maker. See, sometimes in ministry, you have to work. I did it for 17 years, doing this ministry and working in a secular job, and so that the church could be open, we could pay the rent and not pay me. And if I would have took a salary, there would be no money for the rent. And if there would be no money for the rent, we wouldn't have a place to meet. And if we didn't have a place to meet, I wouldn't have a salary. So it was a no-brainer to me to just go out and get a job and stay there until God provided. And he so wonderfully did that. And it says in verse 3, and because he was of the same craft, he abode with them. In other words, he stayed there for a time and he worked with them in that craft. And wrought by them their occupation, and they were tent makers. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath. And the reason why Paul did that, because you have to understand, see, people say, well, that's my job. I don't go to church. I just visit churches and straighten everybody out. Well, that's not your ministry. Okay, the Apostle Paul was ordained, called of God, appointed an apostle of Jesus Christ to set the foundation of the church. And so his ministry, the apostolic ministry of his time, wasn't the model for future apostles. Because you don't lay a foundation twice, right? If you're building a house, you lay the foundation one time, and then you build the house upon it. You don't keep going back and trying to build another foundation. And so what Paul is doing here is he's stressing that he's gone into the synagogues, he's reaching the Jewish people, and he was there every Sabbath day, and he was reaching out to the people and persuading the Jews and the Greeks. And verse 5 says this. I'm sorry, let me go back for a minute. It says, and he what? He reasoned with them. What is reasoning? What is that? It's a form of communication, of factual information. It could almost be to the point of a debate. There's nothing wrong with debates, as long as the debates don't turn to hates. Okay? You can debate. It's good to debate, because you hear the other point of view, and you get the other point of view, and you can dig a little deeper and find out where they're coming from, and you can more or less ask them questions about why they believe what they believe and where they get it from and how did they fashion those things. And you can begin to understand their way of thinking. And then what you do is you give them what the Word of God says, and they will see, their eyes will be open, but it only comes through by you dialoguing with them and talking with them. You know, don't close your mouth and say, well, God, reveal it to them. God will slap you in the head and say, no, speak. Okay? And that's what Paul was doing. He was reasoning with them in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. And when Silas and Timotheus were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and he testified to the Jews, what? About the second coming? About the Antichrist? About the book of Revelation? No, what did he testify of? Now, see, in our Bible says Christ, but actually the word is that Jesus is Messiah. He's talking to the Jews, remember, and he's telling them, listen, this Jesus is the Messiah. And it says that he was pressed in his spirit to testify that to them. So, in other words, there must have been some Jewish believers in that synagogue that needed to hear what Paul was saying. Hallelujah. Thank God that Paul was not just some motivational speaker giving them some good sugar candy coated gospel and telling them what they wanted to hear versus what they needed to hear. Come on, somebody. Understand, when the Apostle Paul told them that Jesus was the Christ, he was putting his life on the line, because they were so infuriated because that they knew that they had taken Barabbas over Jesus. Come on. And so to admit that Jesus was the Messiah meant that their whole theology and the Jewish thinking, how can God, Jesus be God? How can he be the Messiah? There even were some in there that were confused about the resurrection. So, they believed he was dead. Romans killed him. But he was preaching the resurrection. He was preaching the living Christ. And he was preaching that Jesus was the Messiah. In verse 6, and when they opposed themselves and blasphemed. Wow. Ever had people swear at you? Have had people tell you and use the Lord's name in vain and begin to blaspheme God? Start talking about, you know, they wish they could punch God, or they gave him a gesture up to heaven, shook their fist up to heaven, said, if there is a God, excuse me, let them kill me right now. People have done that. And they go 5 minutes later and say, see, there's no God because he didn't kill me. I said, there is a God because he just proved that he's merciful. So after they were done blaspheming, he shook his raiment and he said to them, your blood be upon your own heads. In other words, your life be upon your own heads, because life is in the blood. He says, your life be upon your own heads. In other words, you'll see. He said, I am clean. There's a scripture, it's in the Old Testament, don't remember where it is right now, the reference, but it says this. If you fail to warn a wicked person of his ways, and he dies, then his blood I will require at your hands. But if you warn him, you are free. Come on. And that's how serious we have to take evangelism. That's how serious we have to take about telling people about Jesus. Now, I don't care if you go out there. And I don't care if you throw a 50-pound bag of gospel seed out there and you get no results. That ain't up to me. That ain't up to you. The results are up to God. And all those people that you gave tracts to and all the people that you talked to about Jesus, they cannot stand before God and tell God that he never gave them a chance. He cannot stand before, she cannot stand before God and say, you never told me. And he'll say, let me run the tape for you. Remember this day? Remember this person? And you laughed at them, you mocked them, you ridiculed them. You said no? Okay. Your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. In other words, I'm innocent. From henceforth, I will go unto the Gentiles. Paul said, okay, if you find yourself unworthy of everlasting life, I'm going to go to the Gentiles. Because you know what? The Gentiles are being responsive. They're recognizing who they are. They're not letting their religiosity get in the way. They're recognizing that they need a Messiah. They need a Christ. And so therefore, I'm going to them. Amen. It says, and he departed thence and entered into a certain man's house named Justice, one that worshiped God, whose house joined hard to the synagogue. Now, that must have put a good reputation on him. Hallelujah. Here he's welcoming in Paul and the apostles and those traveling with him, Timotheus, and into his house. And he was one that was joined to the synagogue. In other words, he was faithful to the synagogue. And you can imagine some of his friends saying, man, what are you doing taking them into your house? And Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank God God reached this man, one of the chief rulers of the synagogue. He believed on the Lord and all of his house. Hallelujah. See, back in biblical days, we didn't have kids that would be rebellious to their fathers and mothers. See, the Jewish people and the Hebrew people had a way of dealing with rebellion. You know, you read your Bible, and a lot of people don't like this, but it's in the Bible, okay? And it's not because God's mean or anything. It's just because how many know that the spirit of rebellion is like the sin of witchcraft? Isn't that what the Bible says? Come on. It is. It's like witchcraft. And so, you know, when kids used to rebel, and I'm not talking about, you know, once in a while they rebel. I'm talking about they have a spirit of rebellion. They stand up in your face and they spit at you and they tell you, I'm not doing what you tell me. I'm going to do what I want to do and I'm going to live my life the way I want to live. You ain't going to tell me nothing. And that's how they live, and they live that way all their life. You know what the Jewish people would do? They'd take their son out for a walk. Say, come with me, son. They go walking down into the valley, you know, into the quarry area. And they see a bunch of elders standing around with, you know, rocks in their hands going like this, you know. And the father saying to the son, son, you know what? He says, I'm going to reward you. I'm going to take you to a rock concert. Come on. I thought about doing a t-shirt like that. And so he would take his son down there, and all the elders, they put him in a circle, and they'd stone him to death. And it was legal. Oh, I can't think how somebody can do that. Well, then go into Turkey, go into some of these places that, you know, the Arab places and stuff, when you're a thief and you steal, and you're consistently stealing, you know what they do? They cut your hand off. So everyone that has one hand, they know is a thief. And if you continue stealing, they cut the other hand off and they know that you can't steal no more. You get no place to put the stuff. Come on, somebody. They don't play. See, we become too light. We become too easy. We become easy prey. I was on Facebook and I saw this comment by this Imad. I guess that's what they call him. It should be Imad, not Imad. Iman. And he said, he gave a warning to Christians. He said, Christians, he said, the only thing between us and you, if you don't repent and become Muslims, is a sword. And I replied. I said, sir, you're wrong. I said, because many Christians in America have exerted their Second Amendment right. The right to bear arms. I said, so there's not just a sword that's between you and I. I said, and we will exercise our right to defend ourselves if you come to try to kill or harm our families or ourselves, and you put our lives in danger. Hello? Some people say, Pastor, that's awful. You shouldn't say that. You shouldn't. No. I'll tell you one thing. You'll be so glad. You'll be so glad. If I had my weapon on me one day and I was walking down the street and you were with your little girl or your little boy or your little sister, and all of a sudden a man knocked you to the ground, took your little girl's sister and was going to rape her, you'd be so glad that pastor had a gun. Come on. Absolutely. See, people, this generation, I'm telling you, I don't know how I'm getting off on this, but I just feel to talk about this. Can I talk about this? I just feel we have a generation of really wimpy kids. Yeah, snowflakes. They melt like easy, you know. You tell them Mickey Mouse is dead, man, they go in their room for 10 days crying their eyes out. They can't handle pressure. When 1940s, we had 18-year-olds running, storming the beaches of Normandy with bullets and mortars fired at them. And today you can't even tell a kid something, or President Trump gets elected, they can't go to school the next day. Give me a break. And you know what? Society is just as guilty for coddling them and not telling them, listen, pick up your pants, all right, and get right. Because they won't be able to handle life when they get out there in disappointment. Okay, I'm over. Let me go back to study now. And it says, many believed on the Lord with all of his house. In other words, it was contagious. Christianity should be contagious. It should be so that when you're saved, and it is contagious, right? We've seen that in families, right? We see that in Rebecca's family. Rebecca gets saved, and then her husband gets saved, and we're praying that her children will be saved. And what's your name again? No. Jen and her family got saved. Jen got saved first, then her daughter got saved, and then Haley. Come on. And Alex, I think he knows a little bit about Jesus. Come on. And then Annie came and she got saved, and we had to pray for Tom for a while, but when he came, right? He's like Quaker oatmeal, man. Once he comes, it sticks to you. You know, he's just here. Praise God. He's here, and you know, he don't give up, and he come on. He's been faithful all these years. Hallelujah. Praise God. It says that many of the Corinthians hearing believed and were what? They were baptized. Some people say, I can be a Christian and not be baptized. Well, you can be a Christian and be in disobedience. Because baptism is a command, not a suggestion. And they were baptized. Then spoke the Lord. Look at this. Then spoke the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision. So God still speaks. Amen? And he doesn't tell Paul anything contrary. He said what? Why did he tell Paul that? Let me ask you that question. Something was coming? What else? What else would he say? Why did the Lord tell Paul, be not afraid? Because suffering is coming. How about this? Everybody thinks the Apostle Paul was one great, man, but he was a man because he had fear. You only tell somebody not to be afraid if they're afraid. Hello? There were times he must have been afraid. He was a man. And so Jesus was telling him, Paul, don't be afraid, but speak. Maybe at times he probably debated, should I say this? Because if I say this, this is going to be a problem. And can I say that? I thank God for the preachers that are out there that are preaching the truth and will continue to preach the truth regardless of what people call them names, ridicule them, mock them. Thank God for you. Keep preaching the word. So be not afraid, but speak. And hold not thy peace. I got a friend on the internet, on Facebook, and he's coming against the seeker-friendly philosophy. And I mean, he's out there. And he says, I got devils mad. You have to understand, that seeker-friendly philosophy is of the devil. It's doctrines of devils and damnable heresies. Okay. And you know what? When you start coming against these things, if you're quiet, everybody's happy. But the moment you start talking about it, man, I'm going to tell you something right now. There are Christians, okay, that they better check their Christianity, because when you come against the little pets like that, man, the real badness comes out. But I thank God that there are preachers that are preaching the truth. So Jesus was telling them, don't be afraid, speak and hold not your peace. Look at verse 10. He says, for I am with you. And no man shall set on thee to hurt you, for I have much people in this city. Hallelujah. You know what? When people stand for the Lord, sometimes they're ostracized by society. They're ostracized by the government. They're ostracized by the church at large. And they're made fun of. You're just an old preacher. I've been called the old rugged cross preacher. I consider that a trophy on my shelf. You can call me an old rugged cross preacher all you want to, because that's what the whole message of the gospel is. Hallelujah. I don't look at it as a derogatory thing, and I don't look at it as something old that needs to be replaced. I look at it as something that tags me to go even further and deeper and continue preaching that way. He says, if I'm with you, no man will set on thee to hurt you, because I have much people in this city. You know, the thing about it is, and I told this to Brother Ron. I told him, I said, listen, Brother Ron, I said, when I'm a friend forever. I said, I'll stick by you. And I said, if you do something wrong, I'll tell you. If I feel like, something's not right, and the Lord tells me to tell you, I'm going to tell you. I said, but I'm not a snowflake, and I'm not flaky. Okay, you're my friend. I'll stick by you. I'll stick with you to the end. And so you got a friend, and he appreciates that. And that's to anyone. And the Bible says that in verse 11, that he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. Come on. He didn't teach them how to bake cakes. He didn't teach them how to have a restaurant in their church. He didn't tell them how to do laundry at the church in the back. He didn't tell them how to socialize and have coffee and donuts sitting in the pew and eating coffee and donuts. He didn't tell them that. He said he was preaching the word. He was preaching the word of God. He was teaching the word of God among them. He was teaching them about God. He wasn't telling them about being their best life now. He wasn't trying to motivate them. He was giving them something that they need that would motivate them, and that was the word of God. So many times today, we've gotten a word. The churches have gotten away from preaching the word. We're going to get back to the Bible. Amen? And when Gallio was the deputy of Achaia, the Jews made insurrection with one accord against Paul and brought him to the judgment seat. Oh, now it's going to get good. I'm going to bring him before the council now. He didn't preach anything bad. He preached, was preaching good. He was teaching the word of God. But let me tell you something. When you're preaching the word of God, you're going to have people get upset. When you're really preaching the word of God, people are going to get upset because the word is light. And light exposes darkness. And they don't want to be exposed because they love darkness because their deeds are evil. And that's why the word ain't preached today. That's why, you know, I'd rather have a church of 30 than a church of 3,000 that are just simply motivated and want programs, want to come and eat donuts and coffee and fellowship and eat Kentucky Fried Chicken in the congregation. I'm telling you right now, that'll never happen in this church while I'm the pastor. So if you want some finger-licking good preacher, you have to replace me. Because it ain't going to happen. Now, maybe if you said some filet mignon and lobster, maybe it would be a little different story. Hallelujah. But I could win some of you over with little necks, I can tell you right now. And they were saying to the judgment seat there where all the people coming to judge them, saying, "This fellow persuadeth men to worship God contrary to the law." Now, do you think Paul was doing that? No. If he was teaching them that Jesus was the Messiah, then he's teaching them also that Jesus fulfilled all the law. What they didn't like was their religiosity was being exposed because they were still living under the law. And they were trying to be made perfect by the law. And Paul, of course, addresses that in different books like Romans and Galatians about you cannot justify yourself by being under the law. And so they were trying to justify themselves by being under the law. And when Paul was coming and preaching about grace, that grace and truth came through Jesus Christ, and that his righteousness is what you need, not your own righteousness, that kind of gets people upset. All you got to do is just start talking about Jesus. Right? And now, how many of you have ever talked about Jesus, and then all of a sudden, this whole thing turned around, and people think, and they say this to you. What do you think you are? Super spiritual? What do you think you are? So righteous? Holy? Huh? Come on, don't they say that? You know why? Because when that happens, you know what? Just giggle inside, because you know what? The light is shining, and it's exposing the darkness. And when Paul was now about to open his mouth, Gallio said unto the Jews, "If it were a matter of wrong or wicked lewdness, O ye Jews, reason would that I should bear with you. But if it be a question of words or semantics and names and of your law, look ye to it, for I will not judge of such matters." And he drove them from the judgment seat. Then all the Greeks took Sosthenes, the chief ruler of the synagogue, and beat him before the judgment seat. And Gallio cared for none of those things. In other words, he didn't want to get involved in all of that. You know, some people will get beat. Now, let me just say this one thing. If I end up ever going out to preach the gospel, I will never take my firearm with me. Okay, I have others that will have it on them. And I'll preach and I'll tell people about Jesus. I'm not afraid to tell people about Jesus. And neither should you be. I mean, like I've been taught, Jesus said, if they slap you on one cheek, turn them the other. And if I turn the other cheek and they slap the other cheek, after that, they're out of cheeks. Okay? Katie by the door. Because if you go to hit me again after the second cheek. Now see, Linda's a little more sterner than I am. Okay, she'll do what Jesus said. If one person asks you to go 1 mile, go the mile with them. If he asks you to go two, Linda stops right there. So I've already gone a mile with you. I'm not going to waste my time. And Paul, after this, he tarried there yet a good while, and then he took his leave of the brethren, and he sailed thence into where? Isn't it amazing that he goes to Syria, where all the trouble and all the problems are today? Want to give me some more? Somebody? Praise the Lord. I'm thirsty because I'm still getting over this cold, you know? Thank you. So he sailed into Syria. See, everybody's wondering about Syria and Assad and all this poison gas and all that, and sending troops in and bombing there. And we got to do some of those things. Because it's wrong for what he's doing, killing people with this gas and all that stuff. What are we going to send preachers in there? We should set up satellites. The Christian church, what they should be doing is setting up a satellite dish, going in there, okay? And even if they can't go there in person, but have somebody on the ground that's a Christian, set up big screens and give the gospel message. And just plummet that area with the gospel. But no, we won't do that. You know what? Why? We're too busy with our conferences. We're too busy, you know, asking for money. We're too busy, you know, having people sow their seed so that somebody can have a nice big fancy house, a nice big fancy car. Don't get me started. Okay. Went into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Centuria, for he had a vow. And he came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogue, and what did he do? He reasoned with the Jews again. He had a dialogue with them. If I ask you a question, why do you believe what you believe? What would you say? I'll ask the same thing to the audience listening. Why do you believe what you believe? What would you say? Write that question down somewhere and go home and answer it. Why do I believe what I believe? Why do I believe what I believe? Come on. And then next Wednesday, you're going to stand up. And, well, see, some of you will. Some of you will be in Belgium. But we'll ask you when you get back. Why do I believe? Why do you believe what you believe? Why? And when they desired him to tarry longer time with them, he consented not. In other words, there's a time to go, and there's a time to stay, and there's a time to go again. But he bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you if God will. Well, see, all the faith teachers on TV, they should have. You know, they say if a person says, if it be your will, they say that's a sin. Don't do that. Don't pray that way. They're a bunch of liars. Paul prayed that way. If it be your will. Jesus prayed that way. Come on. I guess that's not good enough for them because they got more faith in Jesus, more faith than Paul. And he spoke and he sailed from Ephesus. And when he had landed at Caesarea, we were there, he went down to Antioch. And after he had spent some time there, he departed and went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia in order, strengthening all the disciples. Notice he didn't say he was motivating them. He was strengthening them. How was he strengthening them? Did they join Gold's Gym together? They started exercising 3 or 4 times a week? Started walking 4 or 5 miles a day? How did he strengthen them? He strengthened them physically, spiritually by the word. He was sharing the word with them and the revelation that God had given him. Remember he said that no man taught him, but that he got the revelation from Jesus Christ about these things? This is what Christians ought to be doing. They ought to be strengthening one another rather than weakening one another. They need to be strengthening one another rather than gossiping about one another. You know the Bible says about church discipline that if there's gossipers, you kick them out of the church? Did you know that? You don't see that happening. You know why? Pastors want money. They want the finances. I said to a pastor one time, he said, well, then all of my church would be gone. I said, well, maybe you should close it. If all you got is a bunch of gossipers. Hello? Read it. It's in Corinthians. Please read your Bible. Please read your Bible. In verse 24, I think I got time just to finish this. And a certain Jew named Apollos, born of Alexandria, an eloquent man, and mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. I remember one time, Linda and I were in Bible school. There was a guest speaker in a chapel. I was feeling kind of down about myself, you know. You know how you get that sometimes, you get kind of down. I was feeling kind of down about myself and my call. I didn't know what God wanted. Here we were stuck up in the Adirondack Mountains, freezing cold, snow up to your nose. Just asking God, you know, God, what do you want from me? And I'm just sitting in there minding my own, about 100-something people in the chapel. Linda and I just sitting there one day, and this guest speaker's speaking, and he's praying for different people, and calls me out and he says, is that your wife next to you? And I said, yes. He says, no. Remember? He said, come on up here. And he started to pray over me. And he said, God's telling me, he said, I'm going to make you like Apollos, mighty in the word of God. And he's done that. And I was talking to a brother today on the phone, and he was saying, you know, Pastor, he said, not many people see things like you and I see. And I said, that's because they don't have discernment. A lot of people don't have discernment. Young Christians don't have discernment. Men, Christian men, they don't have discernment. They have discernment. It's called eye discernment. They look with their eyes. Oh, I'm going to marry that girl. Yeah, but she's not a Christian. That's okay. God told me. I said, no, he didn't. God will never tell you to marry an unbeliever. The Bible says don't be yoked together with an unbeliever. How can he tell you one thing and the Bible say another thing? Come on. People don't like that. Same with women. Women look at guys, oh, God, you know, I feel it in my heart. Don't feel your heart. Your heart's wicked above all things. Don't go by your heart. See, you start talking to people like that, they get mad at you. Don't go by your heart. Your heart is wicked. Well, how do you know my heart? You don't see my heart. How do you know my heart? I said, I don't see your heart, but the Word of God does. And it says that your heart is wicked above all things. Unless that don't apply to you, then take white out and white it out. But Apollos was mighty in the Scriptures. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the Spirit, he spoke and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. That's all he knew. But what he did know, he knew. One time, this pastor said to me, he says, you're pretty confident, aren't you? I said, I'm only confident in the things I know. I won't apologize for that. What I know, I know. I'm not being proud. I'm not being boastful. I'm not saying that I only know it because I know it. No, I said, I know it because I've been taught these things and I've studied these things. So I'm not going to apologize for what I know. Never apologize for what you know and never think you know more than what you do. But he only knew the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard it, they weren't intimidated by his knowledge. They weren't intimidated. They went to him and they expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. And he was humble. Let me tell you something about educated people. Really educated people. Because there's some educated people that they're not really educated. They may have the degrees at the end of their name, but if you go to anyone that has a master's or a doctorate or a PhD, and you can't tell them anything, you can't speak to them, you can't correct them, they think you're way up here and you're way down here. They haven't learned a thing. In my book, they haven't learned a thing. The Bible says knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. See, They get all puffed up with themselves and they think that they know everything because they reached a certain level of education. Well, good for you. But here, Priscilla and Aquila, they went to him. Said, brother, you're not preaching this right. But you need to go further than that. Let me explain it to you a little bit more thoroughly. And they explained, and he had the humbleness to receive that. Always remember that. No matter how educated a person becomes, or no matter how educated you become, stay humble. Because you can always learn from somebody else. You can learn from a donkey. You can learn from a bird flying in the sky. And when he was disposed to pass unto Achaia, the brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him, who when he was come, helped them much, which had believed through grace. For he mightily convinced the Jews, and that publicly, showing by the Scriptures that Jesus was Messiah. Hallelujah. And so I'm going to stop right there. We'll start chapter 19 next week. Praise God. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad there are those that will preach the gospel of Jesus Christ publicly? Amen. I'm getting handed a note from the mailman here. Okay, it says May 17th will be the last day of our audio broadcast. The CEO of Mixler is wanting us to purchase a package deal in order to continue using his service. And it says, unfortunately, at this moment, we don't have this within our budget. We apologize for any inconvenience. You can catch us on Facebook, right? So if you're using Mixler now, just go over to Facebook, go to our page, and presto, it'll be right there, right? We'll have video feed. You'll have the same video feed, and you'll still be able to go back into our archives on the webpage and go back and do all that good stuff. So Mixlr, as of May 17th, will be gone. We'll be going strictly with Facebook. Praise God. Thank God it's free. Amen. So, great. So all of you that are using Mixlr, please note that May 17th, we'll be switching over to Facebook totally, so you don't have to get confused. And it's so much easier. All you do is go to Facebook, go there. You'll see it says join us now. You just click on it. Right, Bob? And it's no big hassle. So praise God. Amen. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for your word. God, we thank you and praise you for tonight. I thank you for everyone that came out. Thank you for our guests that came here, Lord, tonight. We ask you to bless him, keep him safe, and Father, speak to his heart, Lord, and I pray you draw him closer to you. And we thank you and praise you. Keep us safe as we go home now, Lord. And also Vicky and Nelson, as they travel, Lord, surround them with your holy angels. Protect them, Father. We already prayed, but we're going to pray again, thanking you for that traveling protection while they're there with her sister. I pray, God, a total protection all around the entire family. And we give you praise and use them for your glory to lead somebody to Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.